announcements. Besides the bulletin, you'll notice there is a flyer over there about our special offering we're going to be taking next Sunday for the United Church of Christ, our church's wider ministry. So if you don't have that flyer, please consider grabbing one. As I mentioned last weekend, what that fund does is it goes, more than 70% of that fund goes to help our denomination's Michigan office in East Lansing, which through staff and resources provides a lot of help to our church and to all the UCC churches, with brochures, with resources, with staff who help out quite a bit. The other 30% of that fund goes toward helping the national UCC office, basically, again, for staff and resources that go to us. So I ask you to prayerfully consider that as a second offering, if you will, to give next Sunday. Also, big hello to everybody out there on Facebook and YouTube this morning. And we have rotated the plants. So we have some healthy puppies here in front of us for the word on Sunday.
I look back and said, oh man, he's already happy.
That water just was sucked up.
To show you and your peace to other people. question for all of you to start out my sermon this morning. I want you to just for a moment think of the time when you first moved away from your house, from your family. Maybe it was because you had a new job or you just graduated from college and you interviewed, went well, and you were now going off to your first job out of college. Think about that for a moment. Your first time away from home, first time detached from the safety net of your parents or whoever was there as part of your family. Think about that for just a moment. Recall that. So while you have that fresh in your mind, I'll tell you what my first time away from home was like. I remember it like it was yesterday. It's like imprinted on my mind, you know, like an imprint. It took place back in 1983. In that case, at time, I packed my bags, left 633 West College Avenue in Marquette for a town I didn't know much about, Grand Haven. It was my first job out of college, sports editor of the paper. My parents helped me jam whatever I could fit into my little green car. I think it wasn't a Chevette, but it sure seemed like it. It was like a tin can, a gas can on four wheels, if you will. Off I went down to Grand Haven, the milestone, that first milestone passage of life. I got in Grand Haven and I stayed with a man who my father knew until the cubbyhole apartment that I signed a lease for could be cleaned for me to move into it. And you know, if memory serves me correct, that apartment building was once a place where horses lived. That's why the building was called the Carriage House. So think for a moment, the first apartments away from mom and dad in a place where hay and horse dung once was at. Yeah. So there I was, a stranger in a strange land, a strange town in my case. I felt very unsettled. I felt very much like that fish out of water statement that we always talk about. I was out of my element. I was out of my comfort zone. Didn't know anybody in town. I knew a few of the football coaches and basketball coaches, but other than that, and people that I was still getting to know in the newspaper, didn't know much. I felt at times detached from God because I hadn't a Sunday school to go to, adult Sunday school. I had not really checked out a church yet. So there were a lot of weekends where I spent the time alone in my apartment. I had a lot of chances to think about things. But again, I felt like an alien in a strange place. There were no Finnish, Swedish, Italian, or Polish sounding names around me like WP. It's Dutch in Grand Haven. Lots of van der this, van der that, van der Forsberg, if you will. Yeah. Lonely nights in Grand Haven. The only saving grace for me at that time was that there was Lake Michigan, and for a guy who grew up on Lake Superior in Marquette, that made up for a lot of the strangeness in this place. So, with all that in mind, and remembering your first move from the family nest, I was very, very happy to make my first trip back to Marquette since going down to Grand Haven. There it was before my eyes, you remember this, the loving eyes and embrace of my family, my mom and my dad, my familiar hangouts and watering holes of adult beverages, home-cooked meals, no slots and TV dinners anymore, at least for a few days, or Mickey D's, trees and mountains, and for this 22-year-old, man, I loved it. It was a big, wonderful deal. Forget high school and college homecoming weeks. Coming home. A true home. Homecoming, as you have checked already with your own experience, it's about being bathed in the things that you miss. And if you can't go home, the closest thing that I think that comes close to homecoming is comfort food. Mom and Dad gave me a lot, but in Grand Haven, I sought it out. For food, for me, today that comfort food would be those $1.79 peanut butter Rice Krispie bars that you can get at the Speedway gas station just around. is two slices of pizza for $5 at the pizza station. Yeah, that's my comfort food.
That's 15 now, sorry.
Well, you can, believe it or not, but you can go up and get two slices for $5. Yes, at the pizza station. Cross my heart, I promise. Yep. So that's homecoming when I can't be home, is comfort food. Yeah. Homecoming is where it's at. Now, granted, our homecoming experiences can hold a candle to some of these wonderful homecomings. How about that U.S. soldier in the Norman Rockwell painting, seeing the happy smiles as he comes back after serving in World War II? I think we're all familiar with that wonderful graphic by Norman Rockwell. How about the woman getting a bear hug from her husband and children after returning home following a long deployment overseas in the National Guard? Homecoming. And when I think of other homecomings, I try to understand the immigrants of our families, including my relatives in the UP who had to have felt incredible joy and happiness going home for the first time in Sweden. In Belarus after coming to Michigan many years earlier and feeling like me and us, like aliens in a strange land. And of course, I know our first homecoming experiences probably can't hold a candle to refugees who today find themselves in tent camps with little or no possessions, not much food or water, all because of famine, civil wars, or war in their native countries. I can only imagine their longing to have a homecoming someday and again feel peace and comfort. I also think not only of the refugees, but I think of the families in Ukraine who are welcoming home soldiers who have been changed by war for the first time. May they someday have peace and comfort. Peace and comfort were foreign to people of the kingdom of Judah. What is part of what we call today is Israel, and it's talked about in Scripture. For more than 150 years, try to fathom this, for more than 150 years, the Judeans have been living in exile in Babylon, and I know we've been covering this. The Babylonian captivity. We talked about it, of course, last week, and we will one more time next week in Scripture. Judea was destroyed, if you remember. And the temple of Jerusalem was sacked, pretty much gone, a crumbled heap of nothingness. Judea and the temple in Jerusalem were in very bad shapes. Occupied for years by the Babylonian army, conquered by the Babylonian army. Many 150 years ago, 150 years rather, they were in exile, the Judeans. That's several generations. And as they lived in captivity, forced captivity in Babylon, they were away from their family circles. And they were forced to live in a strange land with strange faces, strange customs, oftentimes very hostile to their culture and their religion. The people of Judea saw little prospects on the horizon for returning home anytime soon and having any kind of homecomings. They had no hope. They had no comfort. No chance whatsoever in their minds of ever, ever seeing a homecoming in their native land. That is, until, as proclaimed today, in a poem that we hear by the prophet Isaiah. In the very first words, I don't know if you read scripture today, but in the very first words of our passage, Isaiah loudly proclaimed the word of God to a downtrodden, oppressed, and deported people with a message of this: it will soon be a homecoming. Comfort, O comfort my people, speak tenderly to Jerusalem and cry to her. The opening words, it's a cry of joy for the people that they hear for the very first time. The nightmare is over, they had to think. You see, things have changed in Babylon to give them hope. What changed is this. A new leader of Babylon comes on the scene and makes a decision to let any exiles living in the country, including the Judeans, to go home as long as they remain loyal to the kingdom of Babylon. We'll
So in our scripture passage this morning, Isaiah makes it clear that God had opened up a clear path from Babylon to Jerusalem for the Judean exiles. Just like God had delivered people out of Egypt and the bondage to sin so they could go to the promised land, God, Yahweh, again, was promising a new trip for the Judeans to go from exile to freedom. Isaiah's comforting words provided light in the darkness and hope for the Judeans. Soon, they had to think after hearing these words from Isaiah for the first time, the darkness of oppression being pushed down into the margins of an alien society would soon give way to light, peace, and homecoming. Isaiah was saying basically to the Judeans, make plans for your future homecoming. Plan on it. Once you're home, Isaiah writes, Scripture, the temple, God's earthly dwelling place, will be restored. Jerusalem will be rebuilt. Society will be born anew from the rubble. Life will again be heard with happy smiles and laughter in Jerusalem and Judea. Present in Isaiah are signs of a true homecoming that resonated for the people of Judea, and you know, certainly ring true for us as people who have had our own homecomings. What stands out this morning among the theme of homecoming is this. In Isaiah, we see for the first time the true character of God. What we learn in Scripture today is that we truly belong to a covenantal, promise-keeping God. The God that promised to be our God and safeguard us if we would only worship God and obey God's words, acted yet again, was loyal and loving to the people by promising to bring them home from oppression and hardship and give them a homecoming. We hear about God, the Judea and us, can depend on. We hear about a God that is always with us. God promised that. God's word can be counted on for us day in and day out. The word of our God will stand forever, Isaiah said, if you noticed in verse 8. In contrast, promises and help from humans that can sometimes resemble grass that withers and flowers and fade. Today, we are facing some very tough times in this country and in many areas that indeed can make any strong person wither and fade. We face conditions that make us, I think, feel sometimes like we're in captivity and feeling beaten down. Uncertainty and pressures around us can make us feel far, far from home and insecure and not feeling any peace in today's times. But sometimes, this really speaks to me, sometimes it feels like we're alone despite being surrounded by good people. This time, of course, is when we really think about the loss of a loved one. Health concerns, addictions, loneliness, all of that can creep into our mindset right now and separate us, mentally at least, from the world around us and make us feel like we are in exile from happiness. While good people are around us today, we know from Isaiah that God is always there no matter what. God's character is about our Creator that is 24/7, 365 days. This reminds me of the words some years ago, a song that I know you are familiar with by Ben E. King, that could easily be sung to us, my God. I'm going to try and sing this. It's two verses, but you can sing along with me. But remember, this does speak to the Word of God. It goes, in the night, he's coming, and the light is dark, and the moon is the only light you'll see. Sing along with me. See, I won't be afraid, I won't be afraid, just as long as you stand by me. Yeah, you get it? Yep. If that doesn't
gives us hope and certainty, dependability, and always on God, always present with us, and there to give us peace in our turbulence, and give us the kind of peace that we feel in our own homecomings, and the kind of peace that we always crave and we always seek. God's character also gives us comfort for the long days in the dark nights of despair and the hopelessness and the anxiety that we can sometimes face. There's a lot of words for God that we read in the Bible. We've used this word for God before, Yahweh, Yahweh. Let's think of another name to add on to God's title, Comforter. Comforter, like the warmth that a young comforter gives, or the hot cup of tea that we enjoy on a cold night. Comforter God. Isaiah doesn't come out and say this in so many words, but I will. The prophet could just as well have been talking about the human job title that does come up briefly in the passage. Isaiah uses the word shepherd, but let's talk about comforter shepherd. God's character, right? Isn't it indeed God's character like a shepherd that comforts the sheep of humanity, I would say? A shepherd that is concerned about the flock, nurtures us as God's flock, protects us as God's flock, a shepherd that herds the flock back to safety and security and comfort. Sure does. Finally, and if we could only pick one passage from Isaiah this morning, I think it would be this, Isaiah 43. Come, these words that are of great importance, in the wilderness, prepare the way of the Lord, make straight in the desert a highway for our God. In Isaiah's context, in his audience, he is speaking about a God who basically, literally, carving out a straight highway, a direct path for the Judeans to return home from their Babylonian exile, right into Jerusalem, a super highway, if you will. But more importantly, and whether he may have realized it at the time, he wrote these words, the words that I just read from verse 3, signaling to the world that yes, God was going to bring people home. God was a compassionate and kind God. But I don't think Isaiah ever dreamed that years later, the writers of the New Testament would use these words to talk about a new compassionate shepherd that would be coming to earth soon, Jesus Christ. The gospel writers really, really went with this verse 3 from Isaiah. For in Mark come these words from John the Baptist, coming as a messenger to announce Jesus as the one who comes with divine passion. Mark writes, I will send my messenger ahead of you who will prepare your way. That's John. But then also Mark has John the Baptist using these words, straight out of Isaiah, prepare the way for the Lord, make straight paths to him. So in this case, come and be close to God. Walk, go on a horse to the superhighway to God. Not Judea, but now straight to God in Jesus Christ. God walked among humanity, created a homecoming, if you will, by sending the shepherd that we're going to worship, especially in the next 2 weeks. A son, Jesus Christ, who will bring the hearts and minds to us and all of humanity and bring a kingdom of God that we will live and have here and in here. And also, a shepherd, Jesus Christ, that will travel through the desert of sin and aimlessness to greet us when we emerge from it so we can transform the world around us. Jesus, God's anointed shepherd. Interestingly enough, Jesus said later in his ministry that God was not willing to let any of us who were all God's sheep go astray. Jesus promised that. Jesus said he's the good shepherd. That's one of the few times in the Bible, I don't know if you noticed this, where Jesus gives himself a title. A lot of people would say, are you the son of God? He usually would brush that question aside. But he did say in John 10, I am the good shepherd. He said, like any good shepherd, he knows that he would soon be he's seen as the good shepherd around by people around him. And John wrote it down for us. So here we are. We're sitting two Sundays removed from celebrating Jesus' birth. I think it's important for us to look inward this morning and examine how can we do a better job of making straight a path between ourselves and Jesus. By that I mean, what barriers do we have to eliminate in our lives that prevent us from getting even closer to Jesus than we already are? I want you to think about that. What are those barriers? What are those handicaps that might be keeping us a little bit farther away from Jesus than we should? Are we too caught up sometimes in the materialistic side of Christmas? Has our prayer life been poor with Jesus? Are we holding on to something that's consuming a lot of our mental and physical energy and therefore building up a wall of resistance to getting closer to Christ? Take stock in your relationship with Jesus and see what you can do to strengthen it. God was heard in the time of your hope for the Judeans. Any of the exiles, this is interesting, they considered God was no longer speaking to them. I can understand why 150 years in exile would do that to somebody. They felt defeated. They didn't feel like God was around or even connected to them because of the long periods of silence that they felt from God. They felt, where is God? But they found out soon enough that God is present. God is present. Besides looking at ourselves, about our relationship with God and Jesus Christ, I believe we also need to do this as we get in deeper to the Advent season and ask ourselves this, as a congregation in the Church Universal and as individuals, how can we do a better job? How can we do a better job at reminding people, showing people, whether they are churchgoers or not, that God is still speaking and listening to them? There are a lot of people, and I think you know them in your midst, that are probably feeling like the Judeans. They're feeling exiled. They don't see God around them. They don't feel God around them. Be the walking, living embodiment of Jesus Christ so they can see God and Jesus Christ in your midst. Think of that as you see people around you. I can tell you that one of the biggest turnoffs of people who call themselves people that don't go to church, or spiritual or not, but not religious, or have never set foot inside of a church, the actions of Christians to them sometimes don't match the words of Jesus Christ. They know that Jesus speaks about kindness and forgiveness, but they don't see it in the actions and the words of Christians. Something to keep in mind. Here's what else we need to be doing, always doing, I should say. Look for ways to provide comfort and assurance to the people around us, especially the strangers who may feel separated and abandoned and ignored by God. It only takes a few kind words. We take this for granted sometimes, and I do too. It only takes a few kind words or one teeny tiny act of kindness on any given day that can put a jump in someone's step around us and enable them to feel and see God. All because of what you do. Don't take that for granted. Never forget that. The items under the tree for Lakata, the bags of groceries to a family struggling to have food, driving someone to an appointment who you hardly know, spending an hour of time with someone who is living by themselves. It all adds up. It all adds up. It all adds up in helping people see the face of God and Jesus in your actions. Homecoming is a wonderful time, isn't it? God gave us and continues to give us a lot of homecomings, the family reunions, the gatherings with family and friends. The Judeans got their homecoming through God. And at Christmas, we will celebrate and participate in the holiest of homecomings, like we do every year, in welcoming home God. Advent
ask you to continue urging us and reminding us never take for granted a kind word or a kind act that can help someone around us so they can see you by our words and our deeds. Lord, we thank all that make our life easy outside of our family circles. We thank our men and women in the military serving overseas and will not have any homecomings during the holidays. We thank them for their sacrifices, as well as all of those in the armed forces who have made sacrifices in the past for our country, for our way of life. Lord, we also thank you for the people that keep us safe here locally with our police and firefighters and the people that help us maintain the greatest gift, having good health to carry out and spread your kingdom. Lord, we step back from people who are very grateful and full of gratitude for the blessings you give us to concentrate and look at the challenges around us in our world, in our society, in our state. We are mindful of the continued strife going on across the world. As we always do, we pray for peace in the Middle East. We pray for a ceasefire and to a long-term solution for the people of Israel and Gaza. We pray that the war may soon come to an end in Ukraine, especially as winter sets in. Lord, we continue to shake our head in despair and sadness at the continued violence in our country. We witnessed yet again another shooting in the United States of America, out west. We ask for an end to the violence and for a solution that will work for all involved. Lord, we also ask you to shine a bright light on us, especially in this time of the Advent season, as we are so much looking back at the loved ones we have lost recently and a long time ago. We feel the emptiness again in our hearts. And Lord, we are a people, as you know so well, full of worries. So provide us with comfort so we do not feel like we are in exile, exile in darkness. Bring us out of our exile of sadness into an exile of light, buoyed by the thought and our celebration of the coming of your Son and welcoming his birth in 2 weeks. Lord, we pause now and we say to you silently or out loud our own prayers and petitions for you to hear.
say, our